at this on the top of screen and select side by side view. This webinar series is pre-event to our grand event, which is Granny 2020. And of course, there will be lots and lots of other events such as competition and webinar series too. There will be a virtual excursion on the 13th November, a geomodeling competition on the 2nd December, a photo competition on 8th December, and lastly, a webinar and winner's month on the 14th December. For more information, please do not hesitate to reach us at our social medias like IG and LINE. To start off this webinar, let me read the rules that all the participants of this meeting must follow. First, during this online course, all participants must behave politely and obey all the rules. Second, the Zoom link meeting ID and password will be shared by email and WhatsApp group. Third, all participants are required to turn off the audio and turn on the video and using a virtual background while joining the Zoom meeting. And the host will let you turn on your audio for the question and answer session only. All participants are required to use their full name that is suitable with this exciting existing data. Question and answer session will be conducted after the presentation is finished. During question and answer session, it is permitted to ask questions through the Zoom chat room and using your full name and university or institution. Example, full name, university or institution, and questions are preferably asked in English or Bahasa Indonesia. Do not share the Zoom link, meeting ID, and password without the committee's permission. All participants are required to fill the attendance form of all webinar series that will be shared and WhatsApp group. Do remember, to get the e-certificate, participant must follow all the webinar series, which will be checked and observed from the attendance form. Again, for your convenience, please select the view option on the top right on the screen and select the side by side. For those who haven't filled out the attendance form, please do so. The form has been sent to the WhatsApp group and the Zoom chat. Thank you. Okay, without further ado, please welcome Mr. for today webinar series topic as of Are We Living in the Sixth Mass Extinction? Okay, Mr. Randy is one of Trisakti University Geological Engineering Lecturer and PhD candidate at Akita University, Japan. And Mr. Randy, the time and virtual stage is yours.
Okay. Thank you very much, Elisa, as the moderator. Could I share my screen because you still share your screen, Elisa?
Or okay, wait a moment. For the committee, please accept. Okay. Mr. Randy, you can share screen on your own.
Yeah. Okay. Bisa dilihat dengan jelas? Could you see the presentation?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Morning everyone, selamat pagi semua. Semoga dalam keadaan baik. Ya. Hey, I'm very glad because the committee really give me a chance to give some of the sharing knowledge. I couldn't say this is a lecture for me. This is just golden. This is just sharing knowledge from me, because actually my background of research is not the mass extinction. Actually, my background of research is the micropaleontology. I have a responsibility to give a lecture in micropaleontology and paleontology in Trisakti University. But it's okay, because mass extinction is one of the subject when we learning about paleontology. So today's lecture actually is very interesting, sangat menarik. So actually I'm so sorry, because considering that most of the attendants also Indonesian, I think I will elaborate my presentation both in English or in Indonesia. Actually, the committee is very, very, I would say, very sharp, because they choose a very interesting title for today's knowledge. Okay. The next. Most of you, I think, know about the story about the Noah's Ark. So actually in religious scripture of we know about the actually we I think we already familiar with this story about the when the Noah have a revelation from God to save the animals and take the animals in couple to the very big ark, yeah, because the earth will be flooded by the giant and a massive flood. I think this is the first of that first story when we think about the mass extinction, right? Jadi ini sebenarnya kalau kita lihat ini, kita tuh sudah familiar ya dengan cerita tentang mass extinction dari buku-buku kitab suci ya. For example, here I think this is seen when the flood already shrink ya. Ini ketika sudah kering ya, dry up. But this is the interesting, the Simon the Miles also figure out this one. I think this is kind of the, I don't know what kind of animal this, but actually this is a very interesting story when we talk about mass extinction. And as geologists, our paradigm thinking about the geological process always be outset. We always thinking in the two paradigms of geological process. The first is catastrophism and uniformitarianism. Ya. Jadi sebenarnya kita itu, kalau kita berpikir tentang proses geologi, pasti kita berpikirnya tentang proses catastrophism dan uniformitarianism. Ini sebenarnya kita sudah familiar ya, most of us already familiar with this. Apa sebenarnya catastrophism? Catastrophism was proposed by George Cuvier. The Earth has largely, he said that the Earth has largely been saved by sudden, short life, violent events, and possibly worldwide in scope. Jadi George Cuvier di sini berpendapat bahwa sebenarnya permukaan bumi atau proses-proses di muka bumi ini terjadi karena proses yang tiba-tiba ya, cepat berlangsungnya ya, jadi seperti bencana, seperti katastrofik, disaster ya. In contrary ya, di lain pendapat yang lain diberikan oleh Sir Charles Lyell ya, we already know this very famous person. I think this is the person who have put the fundamental of geological thinking ya. Charles Lyell said that the This is a very familiar quotes actually. Sorry. Familiar quotes. Most of geology around the world know about these quotes. The present was the key to the past, and that all geological processes throughout the past were like those that can be observed now. Jadi sesuatu yang terjadi saat ini, proses-proses geologi yang terjadi saat ini sebenarnya juga terjadi di masa lampau. Ya, seperti itu. Tapi sekarang kenyataannya ya, most of the geologists, modern geologists, thinking about the, we can not thinking that the geological process only catastrophism or uniformitarianism, but both of them contribute the process of a geological process that shaped our Earth. This is I quote from the famous paleontologist Derek Eger. He said that the long periods of boredom separated by short periods of terror. Jadi sebenarnya dalam proses geologi yang kita sebut uniformitarianism itu sebenarnya kata dia adalah suatu apa? Boredom. Suatu hal yang ya jalannya lambat ya, perlahan-lahan, tapi tiba-tiba bisa ya, dipotong oleh periode pendek sebuah teror ya, atau yang disebut dengan katastrofisme. Oke. Nah, ini adalah this is the when we talk about the geological time ya. Yeah. So this figure show the when the geological age is comparing to the hours clock. Yeah. Jadi ini kalau misalkan kita lihat umur kita komparasi dengan waktu ya, jam ya, dalam 12 jam itu ya. Jadi akan seperti ini. For example ya. In the beginning, yeah, the formation of Earth beginning in the zero, yeah. Jadi di pukul 00, yeah, itu baru pembentukan bumi. Jadi sampai dengan kira-kira jam 5, yeah, on the 5 o'clock in the morning, yeah, just the eukaryotic cells develop. Jadi baru ini organisme sel satu yang eukaryotik yang punya apa namanya semacam bakteri gitu ya, dia baru muncul jam 5 pagi gitu ya. Sedangkan fotosintesis baru muncul itu jam 2 pagi ya. Fotosintesis just began on the 2 o'clock on the very early morning ya. Kemudian pukul 8 ya, multicellular life develops ya. Mungkin most of us know this event as the Cambrian explosion. Cambrian explosion. Dan juga and then the first terrestrial plant on half past 10 ya. Yeah. This is very interesting actually, sangat menarik ya. Yeah. Karena because the two of the extinction just mentioned was mentioned in this history of clock, yeah. And actually, our time is very, very, very limited. Yeah, just in the very near the end of the time, yeah, the geological process. Yeah, jadi umur sebenarnya umur kita sebagai manusia itu sangat, sangat pendek. Yeah, kita baru sekali gitu ya. Kita yang paling muda dari semua proses itu, kita yang paling muda. Kita baru muncul, yeah. Berapa ini? Dua detik ya. Dua detik sebelum jam itu berakhir ya. Begitu. Jadi itulah sebenarnya proses geologi ya. Very long story geological process ya. Oke. Kemudian coba kita lihat ya. This is the figure of the history of life on Earth. Actually, most of us know this as the geological time scale, yeah. But the geological time scale is not divided by the geological process actually, yeah. Because it's difficult. It's difficult if we divide the time of geological periods using the process, because for example in the uniformitarianism concept that everything happen in reason, yeah, also happen in the past, yeah. So who is the first person who propose the geological time scale? Siapa sih orang yang pertama kali mempropose geological time scale? Adalah John Phillips, ya. John Phillips, he was a English geologist, ya. British geologist. So, he divided the period of we already know the Archean, Proterozoic, Paleozoic, Mesozoic and Cenozoic by the most abundance of life. Ya. Jadi apa yang paling khas dalam umur tersebut, jenis kehidupan apa, ya, yang paling khas. Gitu. Misalkan kalau kita lihat di umur Archean, ya, in the Archean, occupied only by the single cellular life form. Ya. Jadi makhluk-makhluk yang sangat sederhana. Kemudian di umur Proterozoic, ya, evolve, ya, to become lebih beragam, ya, dan lebih rumit, lebih kompleks life form, ya. And the Paleozoic just start the spreading of the, for example, the arthropod, yeah, the fish, and also the mollusks, yeah. It's step by step. The evolution is step by step, yeah. For example, fish just appear on the Devonian periods, and also the vascular plan on the Carboniferous, and the vertebrata, the land vertebrata actually appear in the end of Carboniferous till the Permian. And in Mesozoic, yeah, in Mesozoic, this era known as the dinosaur period, yeah, most of us already know about this period because it's very popular among the child. Yeah, I really like dinosaur actually. And then the Cenozoic, we are living in this period, the Cenozoic period, and we are human. It's appear it's in very near the end of the geological time. So from this geological time scale, we can learn that every period has different specific life forms. Okay. When we talk about the organism, we also thinking about the extinction. Why? Because most of life forms must be die, right? This is the natural rule. And how the organism extinct naturally? Yeah. Bagaimana cara organisme itu sebenarnya dia punah secara natural? Nah, kalau kita lihat di sini, ya, there is a hypothesis known as the Red Queen hypothesis. This is the hypothesis that I think most of the paleontologists and evolutionary biologists know about this hypothesis proposed by Van Valen. What he say? He said that the observation of the constant rate of background extinction suggests that as the evolution of group proceeds, it becomes neither more or less resistant to new change in the environment.
Di mana?
Anak kecil. Di sini. Sebenarnya ketika makhluk itu berevolusi, dia itu tidak menjadi lebih resisten atau kurang resisten dari environment-nya, dari lingkungan yang baru, begitu, ya. Jadi sebenarnya nggak ada pengaruhnya sama sekali ketika dia berevolusi, ya, terhadap perubahan lingkungan. Nggak ada pengaruhnya apakah dia menjadi lebih kuat atau dia menjadi lebih lemah, gitu, nggak ada. Ya. This observation, yeah, proposed, yeah, as I mentioned by the Van Kalen. The continual coevolution of other species prevent species from attaining the higher level of fitness. Jadi apa maksudnya? Jadi maksudnya adalah ketika suatu makhluk hidup, ya, atau species dia berkembang atau berevolusi, ya, sebenarnya dia malah menghambat, ya, menghambat untuk dia bisa menjadi settle gitu dalam suatu lingkungan gitu ya. Dia pasti akan punah karena punya masa hidup gitu. Setiap makhluk itu punya masa hidup ya. Artinya masa dia berkembang gitu dalam waktu geologi ya. Dalam waktu geologi artinya. Dan species and genera extinction curves. This is the curve actually proposed by the Van Kalen, but his hypothesis yeah, indicate that the most species only persist for few million years. Jadi waktu rentang suatu species atau genera itu hanya beberapa juta tahun saja. Gitu. Ya, jadi nggak bisa selamanya dia hidup di muka bumi gitu ya, abadi gitu. Nggak. Pasti ada waktu di mana dia akan punah gitu. Dan every genera has different span of life in the earth. Ya. Jadi setiap makhluk hidup, misalkan ammonit dengan Planktik foraminifera ya misalkan itu berbeda span umur waktunya gitu, berbeda tergantung dari ada pendapat ukuran dari semakin kecil ukuran suatu binatang biasanya dia lebih resisten atau lebih panjang umurnya, lebih panjang tentang umurnya di muka bumi gitu ya, seperti ya kita ambil contoh itu bakteri ya, bakteri itu kan sudah muncul dari tadi ya umur proterozoik ya sampai sekarang gitu ya. Seperti itu. In other hands, for example, dinosaur ya, ukurannya besar tapi tentang umurnya kan hanya di mesozoiknya gitu. Jadi Van Kalen dia berpikir ke arah situ. Ya. Mungkin agak bertolak belakang dengan ketika kita bicara tentang teori Darwin, misalkan tentang seleksi alam gitu ya, karena di Darwin ya, in Darwinian theory said that the environment ya have the influence, big influence on the lives the bertahan hidup apa bahasa Inggrisnya apa? What do you say? Jadi dia bisa bertahan hidup gitu ya, dipengaruhi oleh environment kalau menurut Darwin. Seperti itulah pokoknya ya. Nah, jadi sebenarnya apa sih mass extinction? Nah, kalau kita bicara tentang extinction ya, apa sebenarnya itu mass extinction? What is mass extinction? I cite the dari David Jablonski ya. I cite the David Jablonski meaning about the mass extinction. Is any substantial increase in the amount of extinction, in example, lineage termination, suffered by more than one geographically widespread higher taxon during a relatively short interval of geological time, resulting in in at least temporary decline in standing diversity. Ya. Jadi sebenarnya kepunahan mass adalah ketika tadi sebenarnya makhluk hidup itu secara naturalnya akan punah gitu, ya dalam waktu tentang waktu tertentu gitu ya. Tapi ketika mass extinction ya, nah dia peningkatan jumlahnya itu ya secara signifikan, ya sangat signifikan, ya mempengaruhi banyak dari jumlah genera spesies yang terpengaruh atau terdampak oleh kepunahan tersebut. More than one geographically widespread. Jadi itu secara global ya. Terjadi secara global. Kemudian, nah ini yang paling penting. Waktunya relatif singkat. Nah, jadi seperti apa? Seperti dia compatible ya. Compatible dengan teorinya Cuvier tentang tentang katastrofisme ya. Jadi itu ciri-ciri dari mass extinction. Dan biasanya temporary, ya. Jadi tidak berlangsung lama, jadi temporer saja. Jadi pasti ada waktu di mana dia recover, ya. There is a time when the recovered again, ya. Itu. So, how the mass extinction jadi sebenarnya ya before 1980s ya, no one talk about the mass extinction very deeply. Most of the assumption of the mass extinction is based on the, for example, like I said in the first they just thinking that the mass extinction happened based on the scripture book, yeah, religion scripture book, or maybe doesn't care about the mass extinction before this year, yeah. But the geological world, yeah, had changed. Here, I think this is very important, yeah, because we know in tectonics, yeah, the development of the tectonic theory, yeah. So this is Alvarez Senior. Actually, Alvarez Senior is the professor from the University of California. Yeah, not geologist, but his son is geologist. Yeah. They proposed about the hypothesis on the mass extinction. Yeah. So what they said that the mass extinction of the dinosaur of many other living things during the Cretaceous to Paleogene extinction even was caused by the impact of large asteroid on the Earth. That's why this event is very popular among not only by geologists but also by other non-geologist people, yeah, because the first hypothesis about the mass extinction mentioned about this, yeah, this asteroid on the Earth. Yeah. And then the research, development of research about the mass extinction, yeah, become more developed in the 1981. Actually, that is, I think this is the first PhD thesis that discuss or reveal about the catastrophic event, and this is John Smith. He's a professor from Amsterdam University, yeah, and his PhD reveal about the catastrophic event of the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary. Actually, this is the development of the hypothesis by Alvarez. Yeah, previous hypothesis by Alvarez. And then the next year, yeah, the next year, this is Raup, Professor Raup and Professor Sepkoski from, I think, University of Kansas, if I'm not wrong, yeah, proposed this one, yeah, the Big Five extinction. So they mentioned about the Big Five extinction. And then in the later year, so the Raup and Sepkoski also propose about the periodicity of the mass extinction. And they said that the mass extinction will happen, will appear every 26 years. Actually, both of Raup, Professor Raup and Professor Sepkoski, unfortunately, already passed away. So when we talk about the mass extinction, we have to know first about the background and mass extinction. So besides the mass extinction, this is there is a background of extinction. What is the background of extinction? Background of extinction is the extinction are always happening in the background, yeah, and for a long period of time. This extinction add up to lot of species extinction. Jadi sebenarnya background extinction ini ya berbicara tentang bahwa yang tadi saya bilang bahwa binatang ini kan makhluk-makhluk hidup ini sebenarnya pasti akan punah gitu kan. Dan dia punya apa? Punya rate gitu ya. Nah, punya rasio ya, punya kecepatan ya, kecepatan kepunahan masa, kepunahannya, bukan kepunahan masa tapi kepunahannya ya. Jadi kalau kita lihat ya, nah 96% itu sebenarnya ya binatang itu mass of organism ya already extinct. Already extinct. Jadi dalam umur waktu geologi itu ya 96% itu ya kebanyakan binatang itu sudah punah gitu ya. Dan in contrary, ya, mass extinction only 4%. Ya. Mass extinction kill off a very large percent of the species on the planet at a given time, but because they are short in duration, ya, they comprise a small percent of animals that ever live on the planet. Jadi hanya periodenya hanya pendek, ya. Nah, jadi yang seperti saya bilang tadi ya, pada kenyataannya ya, in the fact. 99% of species that have lived on the earth already extinct. So even though the mass extinction are eliminating around 75% species at the given time, the total percent of species killed off by mass extinction are small, only 4%, because the background extinction add up to a lot of the species over a long period of time. And the mass extinction are nevertheless massively destructive to an ecosystem given the large number of species that are removed suddenly. Jadi dalam mass extinction itu ya, dalam kepunahan massal itu ya, meskipun waktunya pendek tapi jumlah species atau jumlah makhluk hidup yang terdampak itu ya sangat besar gitu ya. Nah, ini ada beberapa contoh ya. This is the related to the extinction background of some of the animals. Yeah. You can see this is the source yeah, of estimation. Jadi every researcher have different to calculate the extinction background. For example, here we see this mammals. Yeah. How about the extinction background of mammals? Yeah. Martin said that the mammals lifespan is only 1 million of year. Yeah. Gitu. When we see, for example, the more small or more simple organism, for example, dinoflagellates, yeah, is protists, yeah, is have more lifespan. Okay. So previously, yeah, we know that the Raup and Sapkowski. What are they? Siapa aja mereka itu? Siapa sih si lima big mass extinction itu ya? Pertama kalau kita lihat ini adalah yang paling pertama adalah Ordovician. Ordovician mass extinction ya. Yeah. It's happened around 443 billion a million years ago ya. Yeah. 443 juta tahun yang lalu. And then the late Devonian ya. Yeah. This is the second mass extinction, and the Permian ya. Yeah. And Triassic Jurassic ya. Yeah. And this is the most popular one. The Cretaceous Tertiary, or this Tertiary actually not used anymore by the Stratigraphic Commission, yeah, we prefer, they prefer to use Paleogen, yeah, Cretaceous Paleogen, KPG boundary or KPG extinction. Yeah. So this figure is taken from the biological book. Yeah. So here is we see the extinction event, yeah, the five extinction event. And this is the percentage, how many species or organism are the affected by the extinction. This is the, for example, the Permian Triassic is known as the biggest mass extinction in the term of the percentage of the specimen, a species or organism that affected. Yeah. And this one, the last one, the KPG, yeah, the Cretaceous Paleogene mass extinction. Yeah. So beside of the these five big mass extinction, also there is a several, yeah, small. Actually, small extinction, or yeah, we can say this is the also mass extinction, but compare the magnitude, yeah, the magnitude to the other big five mass extinction. I think this is very small, yeah? Not as big as, yeah, the five. And this line, this green line, show the background of extinction actually, yeah, the background of extinction. For example, we see in the Paleozoic, the background of extinction it seems larger, yeah, and then compared than the Cenozoic, yeah, in the recent time. And this is the diversity of animals families over geological time were affected greatly, yeah, by the mass extinction. Jadi ini adalah beberapa contoh dari makhluk hidup yang terpengaruh, ya. Yeah. Most of them is the marine animals, ya. Yeah. Apa marine animals? As we know that because compared to the terrestrial animals, yeah, terrestrial fossil, the marine animals is relatively easy to find in sedimentary rock compared than the terrestrial, yeah, terrestrial fossil. For example, in Ordovician extinction, yeah, this is the example of the affected organism, yeah, bryozoan, graptolites, brachiopods, trilobites, yeah, and then in Devonian and of Devonian, yeah, jawlesfish, yeah, also trilobites, yeah, and also tabulate corals, and in the Permian, yeah, fusulunids, yeah, this is the kind of the foraminifers, yeah, it's typical of the set and Paleozoic foraminifers, and also Triassic, yeah, I think this is the Triassic, yeah, the Triassic. And then the last one, the Cretaceous mass extinction. Yeah. Okay. Before we going to the extinction on the Paleozoic event, yeah, I think we have to know about the story. Yeah. The story of the timeline of the Paleozoic event. Yeah. In the Cambrian period, there is a Cambrian start. From the Cambrian radiation, yeah, this is the event when the life forms, yeah, from the simple one to more complex, yeah, known as the Cambrian radiation, yeah, and this red line, yeah, indicate the mass extinction that happened on the Saint Apollosek Ivan. We are going first to the ordo fission Silurian extinction event. Jadi kita pertama ke ordo fission Silurian extinction event ya. This happened 443 million years ago, yeah. Within 3.3 to 1.9 million years, yeah. Also known, yeah, by geologists as the late Ordovician mass extinction, or the abbreviation is LOME. This extinction was the first of the Big Five Paleozoic mass extinction event, and was the first to significantly affect animal-based and communities. Yeah. So I think before the Paleozoic event start, yeah, I think in my opinion there is several catastrophe happened. Yeah, but because the life forms is not as complex as the Phanerozoic even, so the effect on the organism is not so significant. Yeah. The second largest of the five major extinction even, yeah, this is known as the second largest, yeah, second largest in the Earth history in the term of the percentage of genera, yeah, extinct, yeah. It's around eliminating around 49 to 90% of the marine genera and nearly 86% of the marine species. So we can imagine how big this event. And the late Ordovician extinction event, yeah, did not produce major change into ecosystem structures compared to the other mass extinction. Nor did it lead to any particular morphological innovation. Jadi sebenarnya setelah kejadian si Ordovician Schiller extinction ini ya, sebenarnya nggak ada perubahan ya, tidak ada perubahan yang signifikan terhadap bentuk dari kehidupan gitu ya. Kalau kita lihat belakang ya, ini. Sebenarnya nggak ada perbedaan gitu, nggak ada perbedaan. Jadi dia hanya berefek kepada beberapa jenis spesies, tapi pada kenyataannya spesies-spesies yang lain bisa berkembang di umur selanjutnya. Untuk sebagai contoh ya, trilobites, ya. This is the ancient type trilobites, ya. Maybe it's gone extinct because of the late Ordovician extinction, but the others, ya, which survive, ya, evolved to other species, yeah, and also brachiopods, yeah, evolve to other form, yeah. Ini sebenarnya tidak terlalu berpengaruh terhadap kehidupan, ya. Diversity gradually take cover to pre-extinction level, yeah, over the first 5 million years of the Silurian. Jadi kehidupan itu baru recover, ya. Yeah. Itu 5 juta tahun setelah proses atau kejadian Ordovician extinction ini terjadi, ya. Jadi cukup lama, 5 juta tahun waktu yang dibutuhkan untuk bisa recover kembali ke keadaan awal, ya, keadaan awal. Apa sih penyebabnya, ya? What is the main cause of this event, ya? Ya, most popular theory is the onset of alternating glacial and interglacial episodes, yeah. Repeated marine transgression and regression, yeah. The uplift and weathering of Appalachian affecting atmospheric and the ocean chemistry, yeah. And also the sequestration of the CO2. Yeah. Jadi penyebabnya sebenarnya adalah nih pergantian antara periode glasial dan interglasial, yeah, yang menyebabkan terjadinya proses transgresi dan regresi. Nah, kita tahu bahwa bentuk kehidupan paling utama pada umur Ordovician ini adalah kehidupan laut, ya. Dan kebanyakan adalah masih berupa binatang-binatang invertebrata ya. Jadi masih ya, relatif sederhana ya. Relatively sederhana ya. Very simple. Jadi sangat terpengaruh ya ketika terjadi perubahan muka air laut ya, naik dan turun ya, seperti itu. Nah, ini juga mungkin akan mempengaruhi kan? Pasti akan mempengaruhi terutama makhluk hidup ya, organisme yang hidupnya bergantung di pada daerah shelf atau pada daerah lingkungan laut dangkal gitu ya. Ketika dia turun secara cepat ya, terjadi proses regresi ya. Nah, maka dia akan kehilangan tempat tinggalnya seperti itu. Dan juga biasanya di ilmu paleoklimatologi ya, glasial dan interglasial ini biasanya ada hubungannya dengan ya nih, dengan perubahan ya, perubahan kadar CO2 ya, karbon dioksida di atmosfer. Dan itu sangat mempengaruhi sekali, sangat mempengaruhi. Kita tahu bahwa karbon dioksida ini merupakan salah satu gas rumah kaca. Nah, this is the paleogeography setting ya, during the, actually this is middle Ordovician, but actually that Ordovician and middle Ordovician is not so different ya. Because this is this map is only estimation ya. We don't know the exactly paleogeographic setting during that time ya. This is just assumption ya. This is the figure is very popular ya, yeah. Very popular. Scotus ya, yeah. One of the geologists ya, yeah. Who create the many settings ya, yeah, during geological times of the plate tectonics. Yeah. So what happened during this late Ordovician? The immediate cause of extinction appear to have been the movement of Gondwana into the South Polar, yeah, and the global cooling, glaciation, and consequently level. Creatures, yeah, living in the shallow waters would have been habitat cool and shrink dramatically. Yeah. As mentioned before in Bahasa, actually, yeah, because the glaciation process, yeah, have the impact on the creatures that living in the shelf area. The ice age may also have been triggered by the rise of the North America's Appalachian Mountain. I think this is this one. Yeah. The Appalachian Mountain, the position of Appalachian Mountains, yeah, during the late Ordovician paleogeography, yeah, because the, yeah, I think this one or this one, yeah, this one, the large scale weathering of the uplifted rock, yeah, shrink the CO2 concentration on atmosphere, yeah, out of the atmosphere and drastically cooled the planet. And once a sea level start to rise again, the marine O2 level fell, which in turn caused ocean water to more readily hold to dissolve toxic metal. Jadi seperti yang saya bilang tadi ya, karena proses glasiasi itu menyebabkan terjadinya naik turunnya muka air laut sehingga mempengaruhi ya. Kalau kita lihat ini kan daerah shelf ya, daerah shelf. Nah, di sinilah biasanya binatang-binatang di umur Ordovician itu hidup kan ya. Hidup di sini. Ya, ketika muka air laut turun ya kan, nah, pasti dia akan terpengaruh kan ya, akan menjadi kering. Nah, misalkan seperti ini ya. This is the figure ya. Look like ya. Sepertinya late Ordovician seperti ini gitu. Jadi ada bahkan cumi-cumi aja ini ya, tertancap gitu ya, saking keringnya gitu ya, saking keringnya ya muka air laut saat itu gitu ya. Nah. Jadi beberapa teori menyebutkan ada hubungannya dengan ini Appalachian, pembentukan Appalachian Mountain. Ya, jadi ketika Appalachian Mountain itu ada di pantai barat Amerika ya, in the western coast of in the eastern coast of America ya, North America. Ya, jadi ketika dia terangkat gitu kan. Nah, pasti kan proses weathering itu berlangsung ya, karena prinsip isostasi ya. Berlangsung Proses itu bisa menyebabkan konsentrasi karbon dioksida itu menurun, gitu ya, menurun. Dan bisa menyebabkan terjadinya pendinginan. Ini salah satu teori, ini salah satu teori. Ya, karena ada banyak teori yang menjelaskan tentang kenapa bisa terjadi glasiasi tersebut. Ya. Nah, ketika, jadi tadi seperti saya bilang tadi, ketika kan prosesnya glasiasi dan interglasiasi, kan ya, interglasial. Nah, ketika air laut itu naik lagi, ya, naik lagi, ya, malah sekarang oksigen yang turun levelnya, ya, konsentrasinya yang turun oksigen, ya, nah, jadi akan terjadi proses yang namanya anoksik, ya, proses anoksik, dan proses anoksik ini biasanya dia akan men-trigger, ya, akan men-trigger terjadinya pelarutan unsur-unsur yang beracun gitu, seperti misalkan sulfur gitu kan, karena proses anoksik gitu ya, dia berubah menjadi sulfur contohnya misalkan misalkan pirit ya, pirit itu kan terjadi ketika proses anoksik berlangsung. Nah, itu bisa mempengaruhi parutan zat-zat berbahaya gitu, hasil proses dari erosi ya, proses dari erosi gitu ya, karena tidak ada oksigen gitu ya. Nah, maka dia akan berubah menjadi zat-zat beracun ya, yang mempengaruhi tentunya kehidupan laut. Nah, ini cuma satu teori aja, satu teori ya. Ada teori lain dari another theory ya, about the formation or development of the glacier during this Ordovician extinction ya. Some of the scientists thinking ya, the main trigger of glaciation during this event or during this period is because of the movement of the Gondwana. Yeah, Gondwana. We know that the Gondwana is the big continent. Yeah, big continent. Yeah, comprised of the South America. Yeah. Africa and Australia and Antarctica. Yeah. During this time, the Gondwana move toward the polar South Polar region. Yeah. The movement of the this Gondwana has affected the circulation, the ocean circulation, the global ocean circulation. Jadi dia mempengaruhi arus global ya, dia mempengaruhi arus global dan kemungkinan nah, karena perubahan arus global inilah yang menyebabkan terjadinya glasiasi secara tiba-tiba ya. Seperti itu. Some scientists think that the global ocean circulation ya actually affect the formation of the glacial period. There are another alternative causes of Ordovician extinction. For example, as mentioned, yeah, the anoxia event, yeah, is the absence of dissolved oxygen in seawater, also encourage the formation of toxic metal, yes, in example, hydrogen sulfide, yeah, biological waste product, yeah, jadi sisa-sisa makhluk hidup, gitu ya. Yeah. The oxygen depletion when combined with the high level of sulfide is called euxenia. Jadi selain proses anoksia terjadi juga proses euxenia. Yeah. Other scientists also thinking about the influence of the gamma ray burst. What is that? Gamma ray burst. Yeah. It's kind of the hypernova. We know supernova. This is the much bigger than supernova, hypernova. In the nearby arms of the Milky Way galaxies within 6,000 light years of Earth. Yeah. So what happened when the hypernova happened? Yeah. The marine organism with the planktonic lifestyle were more exposed to UV. Yeah. Jadi pada mungkin pada saat terjadinya gamma ray burst ini ya, konsentrasi sinar UV yang masuk ke dalam atmosfer itu sangat tinggi ya dibandingkan dengan sekarang umur saat ini gitu ya. Jadi dia bisa menyebabkan terutama ya planktonik ya, karena kita tahu kebanyakan dari organisme planktonik ini adalah mereka sangat bergantung ya, very depend on the UV for the photosynthesis ya. And also other ya yeah, the Appalachian Mountain as I mentioned ya yeah. But in recent discoveries ya yeah, by Bond and Grassby in 2020 yeah, they suggested that the pulse of the mass extinction was caused by volcanism which induced global warming and anoxia. It's contrary with the previous cause ya yeah, glacial ya yeah. They mention or they think the global warming instead of the glacial yeah. Okay, this is the victims of the Ordovician yeah, extinction. For example, this is the trilobites yeah, and also the echinoid yeah, echinoderms yeah, and also the brachiopods yeah, and this one is the conodonts and also this one the biggest squid that ever exists on the earth yeah, Cameroceras, from the top point to the tentacles is of 6 meters yeah, it's all extinct, so we can find this creature on the sea anymore. Okay, we are actually the committee or the jadi panitia atau moderator, kalau misalkan saya udah mau limit gitu ya, udah mau habis gitu, tolong diberitahu ya gitu ya.
Baik akan diberitahu nanti.
Masih lama ya?
Masih.
Okay. Because it's very still long story when we talk about the mass extinction. The next one, the second one is the late Devonian mass extinction. Yeah, this happened 59 million years ago. Yeah, within 29 to 2 million years. Yeah. During this event, yeah, around 35% of genera were lost and estimated 75% of species. The extinction seems to have a greater impact on the marine life, yeah, compared than the terrestrial life. Yeah, this event, yeah, actually was divided into two events. The first event, known as the Kielwasser event, yeah, the evidence of presence of two distinct anoxic cell layers in Saxony area, yeah, Saxony area. So this event, yeah, this event characterized by the extinction of many cephalopods group, many conodont species, yeah, most colonial coral, yeah, several groups of trilobites, and some brachiopods also extinct. And the next event, yeah, the next event is the Hagenberg event. Yeah, this is the anoxic event marked by the black shale. Yeah, black shale. So this event, these two events actually marked by the black shale, because the black shale is the good evidence of the anoxic event in the past. Yeah. In the Rhenish area, I think in Sem in Germany, yeah, in Germany, the associated with the sea level rise followed swiftly by glaciation related sea level fall, yeah, marked by the extinction of the also trilobites, yeah, and several groups of the cephalopods, yeah, and also coiled cephalopods. Yeah, gonads as one of the group of the cephalopods. What cause of this late Devonian mass extinction? Yeah, most of the scientists think about the global cooling, yeah, followed by global warming. Yeah, so global cooling, after that global warming, possibly tied to the diversification of land plants with associated weathering, pedogenesis, and drawdown of global CO2. Ya, jadi ada hubungannya dengan kemunculan tumbuhan pertama di daratan. Ya, jadi kita tahu bahwa Silurian itu ya, Ordovician dan Silurian itu adalah waktu di mana tumbuhan itu yang di daratan mulai berkembang. Gitu ya. Jadi kelihatannya ada hubungannya dengan perkembangan dari tumbuhan di daratan. Ya. So the process will be explained in the next slide. Ya. The first fossil in the early Carboniferous period is recorded after the 15 million years largely void of terrestrial animal fossils. Ya. Jadi setelah kejadian Late Devonian ini, ya, itu recovery-nya itu baru 15 juta tahun. 15 juta tahun. The recovery of the life, ya, it's very long. Ya. Long time gap. Ya. 15 juta tahun. Ya. Kemungkinan besar, ya, likely related to the loss during this event. Ya, the Endevonian Hagenberg event. Ya. This period known as the Romer's Gap. Jadi kalau kita misalkan kita meneliti batuan umur Late Devonian, ya, itu ada umur yang cukup lama, itu 15 juta tahun, di mana ya itu ada gap terutama ini terrestrial fossil. Jadi tidak ada kemunculan terrestrial fossil gitu. Itu dikenal sebagai Romer's Gap di ilmu paleontologi. How was the shape of the Earth during the Late Devonian? During the Late Devonian, Gondwana covering much of the southern hemisphere. So the Gondwana compared to the Ordovician is much bigger, right? Much bigger. And the plants underwent a significant phase of evolution, yeah, required the protein system to acquire water and nutrient. Broke up layers of bedrock and the deep layers of soil. Nah, jadi bagaimana cara si tumbuh itu mempengaruhi? Ya? Utamanya adalah dia tumbuhan ini kan terutama tumbuhan-tumbuhan tingkat tinggi, ya, tumbuhan-tumbuhan yang sudah punya sistem apa? Vaskular, ya, sistem apa? Tumbuhan yang sudah lebih advance, ya. Dia kan pasti membutuhkan rooting system, ya, akar, ya, untuk mencari nutrien begitu kan, ya. Nah, proses biologi ini, ya, nah, menyebabkan terjadinya mekanisme pelapukan, ya, pelapukan secara biologi gitu kan, ya, terutama terhadap bedrock, ya, batuan-batuan bedrock, ya, dan juga ini tanah, bagian tanah yang dalam gitu ya, karena kita tahu kalau layer ini kaya akan nutrien. So the next is the mobilization of the large portion of soil, and soil promotes weathering. Jadi setelah dia terjadi proses pelapukan secara biologi, ya, yang terjadi adalah secara besar-besaran terjadi pelapukan. Mungkin bisa dikatakan adalah pelapukan yang lebih besar dibandingkan dengan periode sebelumnya di Ordovician. Ya. The relatively sudden input of the nutrients into river water may have caused eutrophication and subsequent anoxia. Jadi proses nutrien itu, ya, ketika erosi dan transportasi, ya, membawa banyak nutrien ke dalam air laut, ya, ke dalam sungai dulu, ya, kemudian dibawa lagi ke laut gitu kan, ya. Nah, ini bisa menyebabkan eutrofikasi. Apa sih eutrofikasi? Nah, misalnya seperti ini kan. Ini for example, this is the figure, ya. I think the assumption of the what terrestrial on the Devonian looks like, ya, during this time, ya. This is the, ya, jangan membayangkan ada pohon beringin gitu atau pohon pisang gitu, ya, di umur ini gitu, ya. Pohon-pohonnya masih sederhana gitu, ya. Dia bisa ini menyebabkan ketika terjadi proses erosi, nah, ini menyebabkan terjadinya eutrophication, ya. Nah, eutrophication ini biasanya sangat berkaitan erat, ya, related to the anoxia. The weathering of silicate rocks also draw down the CO2. Jadi kita sudah belajar tadi, kita sudah tahu bahwa weathering itu biasanya berhubungan dengan CO2 ini biasanya turun levelnya. What caused the global cooling and resulted in at least one period of late Devonian glaciation? Whether what caused what circle Hagenberg given? Okay, the theory on the Devonian mass extinction would impact, extraterrestrial impact, for example, the impact created in the Siljan Ring in Sweden thought to some scientists thought it's a cause of the Devonian mass extinction, but still debated, still debated. And also the supernova explosion, same as the previous explanation, specifically in the Hagenberg event, And also the magmatism. I think there is a impact from the magmatism. Jadi ada pengaruh dari magmatisme mungkin yang sangat besar waktu itu. For example, the large igneous province in Russia and Siberian, were suggested to correlate with this extinction. And the victims, victims, korban-korbannya apa aja ya? Misalkan ini, Dunklestheus, if I'm not wrong, the name is Dunklestheus is the, I think one of the biggest fish ever lived in on the earth, Jadi ini satu ikan mungkin yang paling seram yang pernah hidup di muka bumi, Bumi, kita sudah nggak bisa lagi menemukan dia. And also some of the jawless fish also got extinct during this mass extinction. Not all fish, but jawfish. And also this is, I think this is the placoderms, the small type of this fish. And however, this is a very 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 interesting this fish. Maybe most of you already know this one. Known as the silakan or kuelakan or I don't know how to pronounce that name. The most of the scientists think that this fish already extinct during the late Devonian, but actually, it's still alive. It's still alive, found in the east coast of Africa and also in the north coast of the Sulawesi in Indonesia. Still alive. And this is an example of the Lazarus taxa, or the taxa that in very long period of geological time seems to be extinct, but suddenly appear. Jadi Lazarus taxa itu adalah makhluk hidup, organisme atau fosil-fosil hidup, living fossil. Jadi fosil-fosil hidup di mana dia kelihatannya sih udah punah, padahal dia masih hidup, masih hidup. So this fish is not affected by the Devonian extinction. And also some of the invertebrates, for example, this is the, I think most of my students remember this figure, the Porifera. Porifera, so trilobite, This is also Mucrospirifer from Brachiopod and Atripa, This is a typical fossil index for the Devonian period and also Rugose coral. We are going to the third late mass extinction, the late Permian mass extinction, known as the biggest mass extinction ever existed on the Earth. This event actually happened 251 million years ago. This informally called Great Dying, because of the severe extinction. 56% of genera were lost, and estimated. This is a very great amount actually, percentage actually, around 96% of species. We can imagine the how severe this extinction. Yeah, it is only insect mass extinction also. We know that the insect is the most resilient organism on the earth. However, during this extinction, they are affected. Yeah. But the insect during this Permian, we compare them recent insect is different. When we talk about the insect during this period, we thought about the giant insect. Giant insect. And also the coal gap period, yeah. So during this extinction, no coal deposited. Jadi tidak ada endapan batu bara, ya, di umur sampai dengan umur Triasik awal. Kemudian apa sih penyebabnya, ya? What is the cause of this extinction? This is the most most accepted theory when we talk about the late Permian mass extinction, the Siberian volcanism that trigger global warming and also spread the deep water anoxic waters, yeah, elevated the toxin on the seawater and also the CO2 concentration and in both marine and terrestrial realms. And last is the ocean acidification atau naiknya keasaman laut. Some scientists estimate that it took 10 million years, yeah, to recover, yeah, due to the severity of the extinction. And another study showed a relatively quick rebound in a localized early Triassic marine ecosystem, talking about 2 million years to recover, suggesting that the impact of the extinction may have been felt less severely in some areas than others. Yeah. So how the shape of the Permian paleogeography is one. Yeah. So this is the the cause of the Permian by the Siberian traps, known as the Siberian traps. Yeah. This is, I think, the biggest volcanism process, yeah. Volcanism eruption that never happened on the earth. Yeah. So this is the situation look like during this period. We can imagine how devastating the surface of on earth during this time. Yeah. So what is the Siberian traps actually? The flood basalt eruption that produced the Siberian traps constitute one of the largest known volcanic events on Earth and covering over 2 million square kilometers. Saya nggak bisa membayangkan, ya, proses ini terjadi ketika Siberian traps ini erupsi, ya, karena pastinya sangat menyeramkan, ya, keadaan saat itu. Yeah, this is the location of Siberian traps now. So I took some of the figure from Isozaki, yeah, in 2009 about the superplum winter hypothesis. Yeah. So he mentioned that the first step is the uprising of plum, yeah, and then the large scale of eruption, yeah, because of this missing plum, and then because of the gas that get out, yeah, out from the eruption process. So it's triggered the eclipse phase by the volcanic ash and gas and the extinction of the photosynthetic organism happen. Yeah. And the last is the oxygen depleted atmosphere and the ocean. Yeah. Jadi bagaimana prosesnya terbentuknya si Siberian trap itu, ya. Jadi ada beberapa teori, ya. Teorinya yang berkembang diterima adalah salah satunya adalah superplum. Jadi apa superplum itu? Jadi ada semacam hotspot ya, hotspot besar ya, superplum ya, yang dia menyebabkan terjadinya proses vulkanisme besar-besaran ya. Mungkin terbesar nggak pernah kita lihat ya di muka bumi ya. Dia menyebabkan menghasilkan banyak gas ya, gas dan debu vulkanik, dan gas dan debu vulkanik ini ketika dia menyebar ke permukaan bumi ya, menyebabkan terjadinya gas rumah kaca, efek rumah kaca. Tapi efek rumah kacanya mungkin lebih dahsyat dibandingkan kita berbicara tentang skalanya dengan kita bandingkan dengan masa sekarang gitu ya. Dan itu pastinya akan mempengaruhi dari extinction dari organisme yang bergantung pada fotosintesis. Dan kemudian yang terakhir adalah oksigen. Karena tidak ada fotosintesis, akibatnya adalah oksigen itu kadarnya menurun, baik di atmosfer maupun di laut.
Oke, Mr. Randy, waktunya tinggal 10 menit lagi ya.
We still long story actually. Oke.
Okay.
We'll just give in fresh ya. And so the relatively hot temperatures during the early Triassic, yeah, another story. Interesting. So the Permian extinction is not end just on that moment, yeah. But also, some of the scientists think about the next step, yeah. It's known as the Cenodice extinction, yeah. Because of the greenhouse effect. So this is the victims of the extinction. Really? Yeah, some of the mammals already extinct during that extinction, and also these eukaryotes, yeah, the biggest scorpion sea that ever lived on the earth, and also some of the crinoids, yeah. This is the Meganeura, giant dragonfly, yeah, and also the blastoids and the fusulinids, yeah, the foraminifers. So we are going now to the timeline of the Mesozoic event. Yeah. The Mesozoic event was characterized by two events of mass extinction, one in the Triassic, yeah, the Triassic, and the last one in the Cretaceous period. So we are first to the last Triassic mass extinction, yeah. It happened 200 million years ago, yeah. It's about 7% of genera were lost and estimated 80% of species, yeah. At least half of the vertebrate species, for example, as amphibian, remaining mammals like reptiles, as I mentioned before, yeah. And also non-dinosaurian reptiles. The times went extinct, yeah, and this extinction allowed another organism known as the dinosaur to assume the dominant roles in the Jurassic periods. Yeah. Actually, these periods, yeah, happened less than 10,000 years, yeah, before Pangaea started to break apart. And the most well-supported theory about this extinction is caused by the Central Atlantic Magmatic Province, or CAMP, yeah. As usual, yeah, triggered the CO2 level, yeah, to be elevated, yeah, which increased the global temperature, also triggered the greenhouse effects, yeah, and also the calcification crisis in the oceans. And this is the paleogeographic setting of the Triassic. See, yeah, this is the host of this widely accepted theory, yeah, about the cause of the Triassic, yeah, Central Atlantic magmatic province. Yeah. Okay. What is victims during this time? Yeah, the victims is this is the conodonts. Yeah, conodonts kind of fish, and the fossil is only the tooth part. Yeah, tooth part, bagian giginya aja yang jadi fossil. Yeah, And also the mammal like reptiles, yeah, on this period is, yeah, is totally extinct. Yeah, for example, this Trinoceron, yeah, this is reptile, but look like mammals. And then the last one, this is the last mass extinction, actually the late Cretaceous mass extinction. Yeah, this is the most popular one. Yeah, it's happened 65 million years ago. Yeah, around 40% genera and 76% species were extinct. Yeah, known as the Cretaceous Paleogene or KPG extinction event. Yeah. This event is marked by the thin layers of the sediment, called the KPG boundary. The boundary clay show the high levels of the metal iridium. I will mention later. And the bullet impact of asteroid impact in the Yucatan is most popular theory. Yeah. But also there is a alternative theory. It's of Deccan volcanism. Yeah. In India, thought to be also the major cause of this extinction. And then the elimination of dominant Cretaceous group allowed the another organism, yeah, in Paleogene, yeah, most of the example is the proses penahan massa di Cretaceous ini, ya, dinosaurus ini, dominasi dinosaurus tergantikan oleh mamalia, ya, di Mesozoik. So this is the late Cretaceous Earth look like. So the prominent characteristic of this event is the shock parts. This is the, how to say, the evidence of the asteroid impacts, actually the extraterrestrial impacts found in Sisulup. I don't know how to pronounce this one. Yeah. Set, yeah, in near the Mexico. Yeah. And the re-entry of ejecta on the Earth atmosphere would include the brief of the intense pulse of the infrared radiation. I think this is the atmosphere, yeah, during this period because of the infrared radiation, and most of the organism during this time just cooked. Yeah. Jadi dia kemasak gitu ya, karena saking panasnya karena proses infrared radiation itu. Juga maybe also trigger the locally firestorm, yeah, especially in the North America, yeah, North America, and also trigger also the mega tsunami, yeah, mega tsunami, and also the the mega tsunami deposit can be found near the Mexico, Gulf of Mexico and Caribbean Sea. And the last, the global debris layer, the entire terrestrial biosphere might have burned, yeah, implying a global soot cloud blocking of the sun, yeah, and creating the impact winter event. Yeah. Jadi pertamanya adalah rumah kaca, kemudian terjadi winter, yeah, jadi musim dingin secara panjang. As I mentioned before, yeah, the characteristic of the KPG boundary is this one, the high concentration of iridium. Yeah, iridium is a very rare element in the Earth, yeah, but very abundant in asteroids. Yeah. Also, the delta this carbon isotope also significantly dropped.
And this
extinction actually marked the end of the giants on the Earth. Yeah. We couldn't see anymore. Yeah. This actually beautiful giant organism, dinosaur, yeah, in the terrestrial dinosaur or a flying dinosaur, yeah, even in the ocean like this one, Mosasaurus. Yeah. And also not only dinosaur, but also cephalopods, yeah, known as the ammonoids, also gone extinct, yeah, during this time. And because I'm a microclimatologist, so I also want to mention the differences between the forum universe, yeah, during the before the KPG boundary and after the KPG boundary. This is the forum universe, yeah, during the before the KPG boundary, yeah, it's more larger, yeah, compared than the after the KPG boundary. So another theory, maybe neither asteroid impact or nor the contract. Maybe the cause is most of the dinosaur eat too much, yeah, because of the MACD, also they saw too much smoke, yeah. Or I think ya lambat naik kapal Nabi Nuh, ya, beberapa orang berpikir seperti ini gitu ya. Ini hanya joke aja sebenarnya. And then also the, yeah, some of the very funny cartoons, yeah, depiction about the how the dinosaur wipe out from the earth. So we already know, yeah, about the several mass extinction, but actually there is several mass extinction beside of the five major mass extinction. Yeah, you can find this several number mass extinction. Yeah, just googling or use Wikipedia to know how this several even happen. Yeah, but now we are going to the we want to answer our question. Is there any six mass extinction actually? We are going to the Paleozoic, to Cenozoic. Okay. Cenozoic. So when we see the probable cause of the mass extinction, most of them is the by the anoxic, yeah, the cooling, yeah, glaciation, and also the impact, yeah, asteroid impact, yeah, and also the large magmatism, yeah. But it's different, yeah, on the paleo in the Cenozoic, yeah, there is two unfamiliar terms. I think the first is the Milankovic, yeah. I think most of you already know about the Milankovic cycle, but I will later explain about the Milankovic cycle. And also this one, humans, how humans affected the mass extinction actually, yeah. Jadi gimana caranya manusia tuh bisa mempengaruhi kepunahan massa. Moderator or komite, saya bisa minta waktu tambahan kira-kira 20 menitan gitu ya.
Oke. 15 menit ya.
20 menit ya.
Oke.
15
menit.
Oke. This is a timeline of Cenozoic. Timeline of Cenozoic. When we see time the Cenozoic period, there is no mass extinction actually. There's an extinction, but small compared than the big five. Yeah, no mass extinction. And most of the Cenozoic climate, yeah, influenced by the Milankovic cycle. I think this Milankovic cycle must be explained in bahasa because it's very complicated if I explain in English. Okay. Jadi sebenarnya Milankovic itu adalah pengaruh, ya, pengaruh dari extraterrestrial, bukannya impact dari asteroid, ya, tapi ini adalah pengaruh dari apa namanya, dari setting astronomi bumi terhadap matahari gitu ya, setting astronomi terhadap. Dia bisa mempengaruhi, nah ini bisa mempengaruhi terjadinya fluktuasi, terutama fluktuasi iklim di muka bumi gitu ya. Jadi selain tadi ada faktor-faktor yang katastrofis seperti gunung api, seperti asteroid dan sebagainya macam, ya, ada juga faktor ini, faktor Milankovic, ya. Ini gambar yang terkenal sekali dari Zakos, ya, Menisit, ya. Jadi ada beberapa faktor, ya, misalkan ada faktor eksentrisitas, itu adalah faktor kelengkungan dari orbit bumi ya terhadap matahari, kadang bumi itu sangat melengkung elips ya, more ellipse, more elliptical ya. Kadang tend to spherical gitu ya. Lalu ada juga obliquity. Obliquity itu adalah tilting ya, jadi kemiringan, kemiringan dari sumbu rotasi bumi gitu ya. Kadang dia 23,5 derajat, kadang 24, kadang lebih landai begitu ya. Nah, itu juga bisa mempengaruhi. Dan yang terakhir adalah axial precision. Jadi presisi. Kadang muka bumi itu, karena bumi itu miring ya, tilting, bumi itu miring. Jadi kadang hanya bagian bulan bumi utara aja yang ngadep ke matahari. Kadang hanya bagian bumi selatan aja yang mempengaruhi ke berhadapan langsung ke matahari. Dan itu mempengaruhi nah dalam beberapa periode waktu gitu. Misalnya kalau eksentrisity dia mempengaruhi 400 kilotahun ya, 400 kiloyears ya. Kalau obliquity itu 41 kiloyear ya, dan axial precision itu 23 kiloyear. Nah, kalau kita lihat di sini di umur Cenozoic tidak ada mass extinction, tapi ada beberapa proses extinction ya, bukan mass extinction. Misalkan ini ada proses vulkanisme ketika North Atlantic itu rifting. Karena Atlantic rifting ya, there's also the extinction ya. But I think the if we compare the extinction with the mass extinction in the Mesozoic and Cenozoic, it's not as bigger as this even ya. Okay. And also the Cenozoic also marked by this glaciation period ya. Back to the question, so is the mass extinction current way? So this actually this question is same question on the publication. It's very very popular famous publication on Nature, very high reputed journal. Yeah. Has the Earth 6 mass extinction of the WAF? You can browse yeah this paper actually. So to know the are we in the mass extinction, we have to assessing the mass extinction. Yeah. What is the assessment of the mass extinction? Is to document where the current extinction episode lies on the mass extinction scale. Yeah. It's request us to know both one, whether the current extinction rates are above the background rates. Yeah. Or two, how close historic and projected biodiversity close approach 75% of the Earth species. And the methodology is the rates of the current species extinction are compared to the background extinction rates estimated from the fossil records. But there is a several problem ya yeah, with the assessment ya. Yeah. Jadi tidak mudah untuk melakukan assessment apakah kita ada di extinction di zaman extinction atau enggak. The first is the many extinction clades are under sampled or are evenly sampled. Jadi yeah, kebanyakan dari makhluk hidup itu sebenarnya belum ketemu gitu ya. Belum ketemu atau ketemu tapi tidak utuh gitu ya. Banyak dari tulang-tulang dinosaurus atau tulang-tulang fosil-fosil makhluk hidup itu ya tidak utuh gitu. Jadi kita tidak tahu gitu sebenarnya gambaran utuhnya itu seperti apa, gambaran berapa sih jumlah makhluk hidup yang sudah punah itu kita belum tahu. Yang kedua dan the second is the species for which we have fossil data ya. For example marine gastropod ya tend to differ from those for which we have best modern data. Jadi kebanyakan ya fosil-fosil yang kita ketahui itu kebanyakan kan marine fosil ya. Marine fosil. Sedangkan modern data itu ya include the terrestrial animals ya, dan kebanyakan dari terrestrial animals ini belum ketemu gitu. Fosilnya belum ketemu. Banyak dari fosil itu yang belum ditemukan. So this is the extinction rate ya, when we think about the are we in 6 mass extinction. So we have to compare ya. This is the extinction the long term average of extinction rate ya, jadi ini adalah rate of extinction yang naturalnya ya antara 0,1 sampai 1 ya species per year per million year ya million sorry 1 million year, jadi ini jumlahnya ininya rate dari extinction-nya. Kemudian the current extinction rate ya condition ya is up to 1000 times higher than the fossil record. Jadi ada kecenderungan seribu kali lebih kuat daripada di masa-masa sebelumnya. Dan this is the projected future model. Yeah. It's 10 times higher than the current level. And so for this more detail, you can find in the paper of from Banorski. Yeah. He explained the extinction rate, yeah, compared to the fossil record and the recent time. And also several extinction species, for example, who are the culprits for some of the Holocene extinction species? For example, this is one Javan tiger, yeah, declared extinct on the 1970s. Yeah. And also the most popular, yeah, when we think about the Holocene mass extinction, we think about the dodo. Declared in 1962, yeah, and also the passenger pigeon, yeah, from North America, also declared in 1914, yeah. Tilakins or Tasmanian moth, yeah, also already extinct in Australia, and finally we have the Chinese river dolphins and West black rhino, also already extinct. These are very recent species that extinct. So who is the major culprits for the extinction of this beautiful species? Actually the sixth mass extinction, yeah, is man-made extinction. Yeah. The Holocene extinction, also referred to as the Anthropocene extinction, is the ongoing extinction event because the human is the biggest cause of this extinction event. Yeah. The current extinction rate is the 100 to 1,000 times from background rates, yeah, background rates, and 1/3 plants and animals are endangered and many have already gone extinct. Yeah. For example, dodo. Yeah, maybe you know, you may familiar with dodo. Yeah, the bird from the Mauritius island in the east coast of Africa. So actually, the dodo for a very long periods, very long time, yeah, nggak pernah ketemu sama manusia dia, never, what do you call? Never encounter, yeah, with the human. Then, but after the human, actually, the Dutch, yeah, the Dutch people conquered the island, yeah. Together with the human, also the dog, yeah, and also the mouse, yeah, make the dodo extinct very fast. And what I learned from dodo also, they mentioned the Dutch said that the meat of dodo is very good actually. So the Dutch during that time, yeah, overhunt the dodo. When we say about the human, yeah, this one. Yeah. So the explosion of the human population. Yeah. Jadi kalau kita lihat di sini, ya, setelah manusia itu memiliki apa, mempunyai teknik agriculture, ya, menguasai agriculture yang lebih modern begitu, ya. Dan di sini kita lihat terjadi peningkatan luar biasa dari populasi manusia, ya, populasi manusia yang tidak terkendali. Kalau saya bilang, ya, ini tidak terkendali, ya. Kita nggak tahu ujungnya sampai apa, ini sampai kapan, kan, ya, proses ini akan terjadi. And we compare, ya, the biodiversity, ya, during the recent time, ya, so the human, ya, occupied the 66% of the biodiversity, and the most of the biodiversity is the farmed animal like pigs, cattle, yeah, chicken, yeah, and wild animals compress only this one, 4%. So we can imagine how vulnerable biodiversity, yeah, situation today. Yeah. For example, this figure show the when the human arrive on a specific area. For example, in Africa, there is a gradual declines. For example, this is the rhinoceros, yeah, rhino, the gradual declines. In other area, have the sharp declines. Yeah, for example, in Australia, in North America, the mammoth, we cannot find a mammoth anymore. Yeah, and also in Madagascar, yeah, big bird like moa, yeah, or kiwi. I think we still can find kiwi but in limited number. So the sixth mass extinction, because of the overly successful fitness of the human population, yeah. And so the human population, yeah, makes several major problems. Yeah, for example, overhunted, yeah, the emission from the industry, yeah, and also the kita dijajah sama makanan ini, makanan cepat saji, ya. Yeah. And also this happened during this time, yeah, the pandemic, yeah, and also the over exploitation of the mining, yeah, sometimes the leak of the oil rig, yeah, and also the global warming and the invasive species, yeah, rabbit known as the worst invasive species. So the question is, you still proud to be a human? Because of this problem, ya. Jadi dalam waktu yang sangat singkat manusia bisa mengubah keadaan yang ada di muka bumi. Ya. And also because the activities of the human, ya. Industry over exploitation, sorry. Trigger the increasing of carbon dioxide, yeah, and leads to the warming temperature. This is the very important curve, actually the Killing curve. The Charles David Killing is the first one who recognized the increasing of carbon dioxide, yeah, based on the Hawaii Observatory. Yeah, he make the observe the concentration of carbon dioxide year by year, yeah, increase. And now it's happened, yeah. It's triggered the temperature anomaly. So from the 19th century to the 21st century, we can see the increase of the temperature. Because the human greed caused the habitat loss, drives the species toward the extinction. For example, this is the deforestation on Borneo, yeah, in the 1950s. Yeah, the Borneo is full covered by the tropical forest, yeah, but year by year, yeah, going to decrease, yeah, because of the deforestation. And most of you know this location, right? Our candidate of the new capital. I couldn't imagine, ya. Jadi saya nggak bisa ngebayangin bagaimana kalau ibu kota baru itu dibangun gitu di Kalimantan, ya. Akan seberapa rusak lagi, akan seberapa parah lagi, ya, kehilangan hutan di Kalimantan. Padahal kita tahu bahwa Kalimantan atau Borneo adalah paru-paru dunia, gitu. Dan sepertinya tidak ada yang meributkan hal itu, gitu. Nah, saya itu miris sebenarnya, ya. Miris, nah mungkin kalian mahasiswa gitu, ya, bisa gitu memulai kampanye gitu. Apa perlu, ya, dengan keserakahan manusia mau bikin ibu kota baru, ya, ini akan mau berapa hutan lagi gitu yang akan dihancurkan gitu. Ya. Jadi ini, ya, sorry in bahasa, terus in bahasa, ya. Jadi orang hutan aja bertanya-tanya gitu, siap-siap gusur nih, ya, karena dia tinggal nunggu waktu aja kan, kapan dia digusur. And also the recent project also is very ridiculous, I think. Very ridiculous, in my opinion, of course. Yeah. You know, in your opinion about the Komodo project of the Jurassic Park. Yeah. We know that this is the treasure of Indonesia. Yeah. No one place on the earth, yeah, have these exotic animals. Yeah. But I don't know, I have speechless. when we learn about this news about the project on the Komodo Island. Okay. So is the human derived extinction. So how about the another problem, another cause? For example, is there any potential of devastating volcanic eruption like the in the past? Yeah. For example, we have the Toba and the Yellowstone, known as the biggest eruption in the recent history in the Holocene or Pleistocene. Yeah. But I think compared to the extinction event or the magmatic process on the Mesozoic or Paleozoic, I think the scale is relatively small, yeah. But so it's how to say less impact on the biodiversity, yeah. Jadi kalau misalkan untuk menciptakan kepunahan massal, saya pikir kalau misalkan satu sendiri aja Gunung Toba meletus itu belum cukup gitu untuk membuat satu mass extinction. Mungkin di suatu daerah di Indonesia mungkin bisa terjadi extinction massal gitu, tapi mungkin kalau semuanya, kalau semua gunung mungkin, ya, karena kalau kita komparasi misalkan dengan yang si Siberian Traps, ya, itu kan ya nggak ada apa-apanya lah gitu ya, masih relatif kecil gitu ya. Gitu. Jadi apakah ada ancaman terhadap gunung api? Mungkin bisa terjadi ancaman gitu, kita siap-siap aja gitu, karena emang prediksi gunung api adalah ilmu yang paling sulit kayaknya, gitu ya, memprediksi kapan gunung api meletus gitu. Tapi kita bisa belajar dari sejarah letusan gunung api tersebut. Bisa jadi ini adalah our doomsday. Yeah. And another possibility is the asteroid impact. Yeah. Is there any asteroid impact in the near future, like the KPG boundary? Yeah. So there is a Torino scale, yeah, the methods of categorizing impact. Yeah. So actually the NASA has discovered the Apophis, Apophis asteroid, asteroid discovered in 2004 and expected to come within around 31,000 kilometers from Earth's surface, very near, and this is the highest ever Torino scale in a 4 scale actually. And the change of this the Apophis encounter the Earth is the 2.7%, yeah, in the 2029, yeah, it's very near. So the current calculation is the 12.3 to hit one in 12.3 million change to hit the Earth in 27. So we have to prepare because of the giant asteroid. So the final phase of the life on Earth. So this is, I think, the final life form will be the doomsday of the life form. Yeah. What happened? Sorry. Sun has entered the red giant phase. This is the phase of the death of the sun. Yeah. Eventually, warming expanding of the sun will both cause a greater mass extinction, having the potential to wipe out the even microbes. In other words, the Earth is completely surprised. And since this will only happen late in Earth's life, which will cause the final mass extinction in the Earth history, yeah, it will happen 5 billion years from now. So we still alive. Yeah. Because it's very, very long time. I think human already extinct during that time. Or maybe Earth already occupied by alien or something like that. Okay, and another theory. Okay. I think this is the theory. Yeah, this is a intermezzo. Yeah. I think compared to other cause of the mass extinction, yeah, dibandingkan dengan extinction yang sebelumnya, I think penyebab utama yang terbesar adalah power of magma. Jadi, ya, jadi ini saya ingat sekali baca buku Doraemon, ya, this very popular manga, ya, talk about the Nobita. Dia minta sama Doraemon untuk dibuatin, ya, untuk membuat iri si Giant sama si Suneo, kan, ya, akhirnya dibuatin miniatur bumi, ya, Tapi ya biasalah ibu-ibu kan ya, nggak ngerti anak itu lagi ngerjain apa gitu ya, main buang aja. Nah, ternyata si Doraemon sama si Nobita tuh dari dalam ternyata, ya kan? Dibuang dan menyebabkan terjadinya mass extinction gitu kan. It's very interesting and interesting story ya, yeah, from this manga. And actually I learn much about the earth actually from this manga Doraemon. Okay, this is the end of my sharing knowledge. So from I finish my presentation. So there is a quote from the famous paleontologist George Gaylord Simpson. Yeah. So I read the quotes in the history of life. It is the striking fact that a major change in the taxonomic groups occupying various ecological positions do not, as a rule, result from the direct competition of the groups concerned in each case and the survival of the fittest. On the contrary, the usual sequence is for one dominant group to die out, leaving the zone empty before the other groups become abundant. Jadi pada dasarnya sebenarnya proses dari extinction event ini adalah suatu yang ilmiah. Jadi ketika satu makhluk hidup itu punah, dia akan digantikan dengan makhluk hidup yang lain. Karena kita kembali lagi tadi ya, Red Queen hipotesis bahwa sebenarnya semua makhluk hidup itu pasti akan mengalami kepunahan. Begitu kira-kira. Okay, thank you very much for your question. To we already learn about the mass extinction. If you have a question, I greatly ada pertanyaan silakan in English or in Indonesia directly.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Andy, for the insightful presentation. And then next up, we will be opening our question and answer session. As mentioned and explained before, for those who wish to ask question, please write down the question with your full name and the university or institution you are from in the chat box. And I will be announce it to Mr. Andy for the question. Bagi peserta yang ingin bertanya, bisa langsung saja mengisi nama dan universitas atau institusi dari mananya pada chat box. Nanti akan saya sampaikan ke Mr. Andy. Okay, Mr. Andy, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, this is the first question from Denny, Trisakti University. The question is, the biggest mass extinction that we know is the Great Dying Event. Yet, the ecological succession of the event was enormous. Do you think that this extinction today is necessity and necessary for the Earth continuation?
Oh, of course, yeah. Ini pakai bahasa Inggris aja atau pakai bahasa Indonesia? Jawabnya pakai bahasa Indonesia.
Boleh pakai bahasa Indonesia jawabnya.
Ini nanya saya tahu orang Indonesia, gitu ya. Jadi sebenarnya apa ya? Seperti yang tadi dibilang bahwa proses extinction itu proses yang ilmiah, gitu. Proses yang ilmiah terjadi, gitu ya. Dan biasanya ketika terjadi proses extinction atau proses kepunahan gitu ya, makhluk atau organisme yang menguasai atau yang tipikal pada zaman itu ya, itu akan tergantikan gitu, tergantikan. Jadi seperti ada apa ya, seperti ada cycle gitu, ada cycle antara satu jenis kehidupan dengan jenis kehidupan yang lain seperti itu. Jadi tentu itu sangat penting bagi kehidupan makhluk hidup gitu. Jadi, misalkan kita berasumsi saja. Misalkan makhluk hidup terus-terusan gitu, ya berevolusi terus gitu. Ya kan? Nah, pasti akan ada makhluk hidup yang kecenderungannya apa? Lebih dominan dibandingkan dengan makhluk hidup yang lain. Misalkan kita ambil contoh lah, misalkan sarang gitu ya. Manusia gitu kan. Kan lebih dominan gitu kan. Sehingga ada makhluk hidup lain gitu yang tidak bisa bertahan gitu karena dia kurang dominan ya, kurang banyak pengaruhnya. Nah, tentu
perlu ada apa? Perlu ada mekanisme alam atau apa istilahnya tuh apa? Interupsi ya, interupsi dari alam gitu, dari ada interupsi ya yang membuat bumi itu menjadi seimbang gitu, menjadi seimbang. Jadi seimbang sehingga ada pergantian antara hidup. Ya, itu penting. Misalkan kalau misalkan nggak ada Permian extinction, misalkan nggak akan ada dinosaurus gitu. Yang terjadi adalah si echinodermata apa invertebrata itu semuanya akan terus berkembang aja, akan terus berevolusi gitu ya. Unstoppable evolution gitu kan. Seperti itu kira-kira. Gimana? Denny okay. Udah cukup?
Ya, sudah cukup, Bang.
Oke, okay. Terima kasih.
Oke, okay. So this is for the next question. Is from Mr. Irfan from Trisakti University. The question is, I'm sorry, I wanna ask why is it called a mass extinction when in reality most of those organisms of evolved into the modern organism we see today.
Okay.
You can answer in Indonesia or in English.
Okay, in Indonesia aja. Ya. Pada kenyataannya, tidak semua makhluk hidup itu berevolusi, Irfan. Tidak semuanya makhluk hidup itu berevolusi, gitu ya. Misalkan tadi kalau kita lihat Lazarus taxa. Ada beberapa taksa misalkan ya. Nah, Lazarus taksa ini ya. Ikan selakan ini dari umur Devonian sampai sekarang bentuknya begitu-begitu aja gitu. Enggak berevolusi gitu ya. Mempertahankan bentuk hidupnya yang sama seperti waktu dia hidup di zaman Devonian. Jadi tidak semua makhluk hidup sebenarnya berevolusi. Jadi ada makhluk hidup yang berevolusi ya, karena dia bisa bertahan dari mass extinction ya. Ada makhluk hidup yang tidak bisa bertahan gitu. Misalkan dinosaurus ya. Dinosaurus tidak berevolusi. Sebenarnya kalau kita bicara dinosaurus punah juga tidak semua dinosaurus punah. Burung itu sebenarnya dinosaurus gitu. Adalah salah satu kelompok dari dinosaurus gitu ya. Nah, burung yang bertahan gitu bisa bertahan ya, sedangkan dinosaurus lain yang reptil gitu ya. Besar gitu ya. T-Rex misalkan dia tidak berevolusi ya, sudah apa namanya selesai hidupnya gitu ya. Karena menemui ajalnya begitu di zaman ya. Jadi sebenarnya itu ya, jadi tidak semua makhluk hidup itu berevolusi. Gimana Irfan?
Baik, terima kasih Bang.
Okay, I'm sorry, Sir Randy. This is Mr. Awang Satyana from Independent Institution. He wants to give some comment for this webinar series. So for Mr. Awang, you can open your mic and open your video too for the question and answer to Mr. Randy.
Yeah, terima kasih, Mbak Elisa. Saya pakai bahasa Indonesia aja ya.
Ya, nggak apa-apa, Awang.
Ya, yeah. Terima kasih Mas Randy.
Oke, okay, it's okay.
Ya, yeah. Topik yang menarik, yeah. Presentasinya juga sangat baik. Saya mau ada dua hal ya. Pertanyaan, yang pertama komen, yang kedua pertanyaan. Yang pertama tentang penyebab kepunahan massa ya atau mass extinction itu kan seringnya kompleks gitu. Jadi tidak tunggal gitu. Jadi banyak hal gitu. Saya pernah menulis satu paper atau artikel gitu ya tentang kepunahan massa di ujung Permian dan di ujung Kretasius. Itu kan yang Permian kan yang paling besar ya,
gitu.
Ya yang Great Dying gitu. Nah terus tadi Mas Randy menyebutkan ada Siberian Trap dan yang di Late Kretasius itu Deccan Trap. Nah ada teori yang lain sebenarnya itu penyebab utamanya itu sebenarnya Terex yang menurut salah satu teori ya. Walaupun kalau yang ujung Permian itu ada juga karena anoksia gitu yang besar di laut sendiri gitu. Nah tapi hal itu juga bersamaan dengan kejadian kita punya Siberian Trap yang besar sekali. Nah terus ada teori yang namanya antipodal. Mas Rini pernah dengar nggak istilah itu antipodal? Ya, oke. Okay. Jadi kita punya satu asteroid impact di satu sisi, di satu sisi bumi. Nah, nanti di sisi yang lainnya itu yang persis lurus di bawahnya, tapi di baliknya itu kan posisinya antipodal namanya.
Antipodal, betul.
Nah, itu menyebabkan satu vulkanisme yang besar. Nah, belakangan memang ditemukan gitu sih. Jadi, pertama kali ditemukan memang kita punya Siberian Trap gitu ya, besar sekali. Nah, terus kita belakangan menemukan si kraternya itu, impact kraternya itu ternyata ada di Australia seumur kira-kira gitu. Jadi, kita punya satu benturan di Australia. Nah, itu kan benturannya itu begitu besar karena asteroid, itu jadi seolah-olah seperti ringing the bell gitu. Jadi si bumi itu kayak dipukul aja kan.
Ada.
Ya, ringing the bell bergetar. Nah, itu sebenarnya menggerakkan mental plume-nya. Mental plume, sehingga mental plume-nya itu begitu banyak dan dia larinya tuh ke sisi antipodalnya. Yang dalam hal ini dia di Siberian gitu, yang umurnya ujung Permian. Kemudian yang latest Cretaceous juga sama gitu. Kita punya, itu kan lebih terkenal ya, kita punya six kulub crater ya di Yucatan itu. Nah, terus posisi antipodalnya kan Deccan Trap kan di India kan. Walaupun saat itu posisi India kan masih berjalan gitu posisinya sekarang di itu apa di tidak jauh dari Madagaskar. Nah, sesudah dipukul oleh asteroid kemudian menggerakkan mental plume yang begitu banyak ke sisi antipodalnya, baru kemudian peristiwa berikutnya itu terjadi gitu yang tadi Mas Randy terangkan. Berantai lah ya. Jadi berantai. Kita punya vulkanisme yang sangat besar, vulkanisme akan mengubah winter vulkanisme, dan akhirnya ya kepunahan massal yang terjadi. Tapi seolah-olah memang kita tidak punya satu mekanisme tunggal, banyaknya itu composite gitu, untuk terjadi mass extinction gitu. Nah itu komen saja. Tadi saya belum lihat Mas Rini menjelaskan soal itu gitu. Jadi sebenarnya ada juga teori seperti itu. Walaupun mungkin ada teori-teori yang lain, misalnya vulkanisme itu menyebabkan karena begitu banyak CO2 muncul terus masuk ke laut jadi asam misalnya kan, asid gitu kan si air lautnya. Bisa seperti itu. Itu komen yang pertama. Nah, pertanyaan saya adalah yang tadi yang Mas Rini bisa keselihat ini enggak apa perbedaan foram yang sebelum dan sesudah KPG boundary itu kan berbeda sekali itu. Nah, ini. Ya. Kalau yang awal itu ini kan skalanya sama ya, sudah dibikin sama. Itu kan lebih besar-besar dan lebih ini ya, lebih kompleks ya. Dibandingkan dengan yang sesudahnya itu Lilliput effect itu kira-kira apa ya penyebabnya ya, Mas Rendy?
Kalau saya sih mungkin berpendapat karena mungkin faktor ininya, Pak. Faktor apa ya? Faktor laut mungkin apa namanya? Kondisi lingkungannya gitu. Lingkungan lautnya berbeda antara karena begini Pak, kalau kita bicara tentang antara Mesozoik dan Paleozoik begitu, itu kan ini yang saya pelajari gitu ya, ada perbedaan sirkulasi air laut gitu. Jadi kalau misalkan di Cenozoik itu lebih dipengaruhi banyaknya oleh arus-arus permukaan yang sifatnya dingin gitu Pak.
Yang Paleozoik ya?
Ya di bukan di Paleozoik, di Cenozoik.
Oke.
Sedangkan kalau di Paleozoik itu kebanyakan itu adalah arus-arus yang karena kita masih punya tetis ya Pak, paleotetis kan.
Iya.
Yeah. Paleotetis, jadi kebanyakan adalah arus-arus yang dipengaruhi oleh arus tropical Pak. Jadi kemungkinan di situ oligotropik. Nah, jadi mungkin itu Pak mempengaruhi kepada ini pembentukan dari, karena kita tahu kalau oligotropik ini kan foraminifera ini kan makhluk yang apa ya? Dia tuh oportunis ya Pak. Makhluk yang oportunis gitu, sangat terpengaruh oleh
kondisi ya,
lingkungan gitu dan kondisi lingkungan gitu Pak. Jadi benar-benar terlihat sekali gitu. Kalau saya rasa sih arah situ Pak ininya.
Oke. Mungkin pada saat KPG Boundary juga si oceanographic nature berubah ya, sehingga ikut mempengaruhi kondisi makhluk hidupnya. Kira-kira juga bisa seperti itu ya. Oke, Mas Randy, makasih. Mbak Elisa, makasih juga.
Awang, ya. Yuk. Diskusinya.
Ya.
Oke, thank you for Mr. Awang for the comment and for the question. And then, is there any question for this session? If there are any question again, you can mention your name and your university or institution you are from in the chat box and also your question.
Saya boleh minum ya?
Boleh. Oke, untuk question and answer atau tanya jawab masih kita buka. Bagi kalian yang ingin bertanya, bisa langsung saja mengisi nama dan juga universitas atau institusi dari mana di chat box Zoom, serta pertanyaan untuk series kali ini. Nanti akan saya langsung pandu ke Mr. Randy. Okay, this is the next question from Mr. Muhammad Salsabila from University Trisakti University. The question is, what can we learn from the past 5 extinction, even so that we can prevent this extinction? You can answer in English or in Indonesia.
What can we learn from past 5 extinction event so that we can prevent this extinction? So what can we learn that because the extinction is very devastating ya, karena sebenarnya mass extinction itu sebenarnya suatu hal yang sangat sangat menyeramkan gitu kan untuk suatu makhluk hidup gitu kan, terutama kita manusia gitu kan, karena sekarang kita manusia ini dalam kita sebenarnya ada mendekati doomsday kita gitu, karena kita sekarang yang paling dominan gitu kan, menguasai segala hal gitu. Pasti nah, menurut si teori tadi hipotesisnya apa namanya Red Queen itu kan dibilang katanya pasti akan akan punah semua gitu, semuanya akan punah, hanya ada waktu, ada rentang waktunya gitu kan. Nah, ya karena kita tahu seberapa besarnya atau seberapa menyeramkan masa extinction itu, nah, maka kita melakukan pencegahan ya. Bisa melakukan pencegahan, terutama kita bisa melakukan apa mitigasi dengan kita mengetahui bagaimana proses itu berlangsung gitu. Misalkan contoh gitu di Cenozoic ini, di Holocene ini ya, nah, sekarang kan kita sedang mengalami yang namanya global pemanasan global ya, pemanasan global. Kita bisa belajar gitu ya dari pemanasan global yang pernah terjadi sebelumnya di masa lalu gitu ya, kita belajar ya. Nah, apakah ya ketika kan sekarang gini nih, karena gini misalkan sekarang ada beberapa orang yang percaya dengan global warming atau orang yang percaya tidak percaya dengan global warming gitu. Nah, sebenarnya dua opini ini ya kita buktiin aja lewat evidence gitu ya, empirical evidence gitu ya. Kita lihat bagaimana masa lalu itu ya, seperti tadi Pak Awang bilang gitu, bagaimana berbagai macam efek gitu ya, berbagai macam penyebab itu ya berkontribusi terhadap kepunahan massal gitu. Sebagai contoh misalkan gitu, kita pernah tahu bahwa ada yang namanya Large Ignoy Province yang bisa menyebabkan terjadinya erupsi besar-besaran gitu. Ya, apakah dengan ilmu geologi kita gitu ya, kita mengestimasi gitu apakah akan terjadi, mungkin bisa terjadi lagi hal seperti itu, misalkan ya gitu kan. Atau tadi yang kita balik lagi ke global pemanasan global gitu. Apakah gitu, tren dari pemanasan global di masa lalu gitu ya, nah, kita bisa analogikan dengan sekarang gitu, lalu kita bisa perkirakan seberapa parah nanti kalau misalkan itu terjadi seperti itu. Ya, kita bisa membandingkan seberapa parah gitu. Ya, antara yang kita sebabkan gitu karena antroposen gitu ya, karena manusia, penyebab manusia dengan penyebab alam yang pernah terjadi sebelumnya. Kira-kira seperti itu. Ya. Jawab enggak?
For Mr. Sabil, is there any question?
Jawab. Oke, terima kasih Sabil. Thank you very much.
Okay. Is there any question again?
I think most of the participant are exhausted.
Okay, this is maybe this is the last question. The question is from Cornelis Maranatha from ITAT Surabaya. The question is there a plan or prevention on that has been prepared to prevent mass extinction as human can learn from the past?
Plan of prevention. Yes. Actually, some of the people have very concerned about the mass extinction will happen in the near future period, for example, but in others very ignorance, ya. Jadi sebenarnya beragam gitu, beragam orang gitu. Ya. Misalkan baru-baru ini, misalkan saya agak bawa-bawa sedikit, sebenarnya nggak bermaksud ke politik ya, cuman kan kita lihat bagaimana Presiden Amerika yang sebelumnya itu kan dia lebih cenderung ya denying tentang perubahan iklim apa segala macam gitu, katanya bumi ini nggak terjadi apa-apa, kita hidup baik-baik saja, katanya gitu kan. Pada kenyataannya sebenarnya bumi tidak baik-baik saja sebenarnya gitu kan ya. Ada beberapa orang misalkan sudah prevensi apa namanya, pencegahannya itu macam-macam. Prevention is very very. Ada yang benar-benar niat gitu ya, dia bikin misalkan bikin kapsul gitu ya, karena dia percaya bahwa bumi akan mengalami kepunahan gitu kan, terjadi kepunahan terhadap organisme di muka bumi. Jadi dia bikin kapsul, katanya dia mau pergi ke Mars. Jadi ada yang seperti itu gitu kan ya. Ada beberapa misalkan NASA ya, beberapa negara mempersiapkan untuk peluncuran wahana untuk mempersiapkan Mars sebagai the next habitable planets for human being, for example, ya kan, seperti itu. Ya. Tapi sebenarnya itu kalau misalkan kalau bahasa saya nih, yang bermodal gitu ya, bermodal seperti itu. Tapi sebenarnya ada hal-hal kecil yang bisa kita lakukan gitu untuk mencegah terjadinya pemanasan global, mass extinction. Ya. Salah satunya dengan pola hidup gitu. Karena kita tahu bahwa yang Holocene ini kan triggernya adalah manusia gitu, karena ya, banyak dari aktivitas manusia ini yang memicu terjadinya perubahan-perubahan yang radikal, ya. Baik itu atmosfer apa segala macam kan ya, ekologi apa segala macam. Nah, kita mulai dari hal-hal yang kecil. Misalkan menggunakan reuse gitu, memang terlihat seperti normatif ya, memang terlihat normatif gitu, tapi ya kita mulai dari individual gitu. Ketika kita tidak bisa berharap kepada institusi atau otoritas yang lebih tinggi, kita mulai dari yang individual gitu. Memang terdengar normatif sepertinya, tapi mungkin kalau satu orang berpikir seperti itu memang nggak ada efeknya. Tapi kalau misalkan kampanye ini terus dijalankan gitu, penggunaan 3R ya, reuse, recycle, reduce seperti itu misalnya. Ya. Terus yang kedua, jangan terlalu over exploited, misalkan penggunaan sumber daya energi misalkan gitu ya. Bisa mungkin kita kurangi pengguna sumber daya energi migas, karena yang kita tahu bahwa peningkatan tadi kalau kita lihat killing curve itu ya, itu sebenarnya kan dimulai ya sejak manusia itu bisa memanfaatkan energi fosil kan ya. Energi fosil gitu. Padahal kita tahu ketika terperangkapnya karbon itu di dalam energi fosil gitu ya, itu ada sebenarnya kan mekanisme alami gitu kan, untuk menjaga keseimbangan ya, keseimbangan siklus karbon di muka bumi gitu kan. Lah terjadinya over exploitation ya, yang berlebihan dan penggunaan yang berlebihan ya, overuse of the karbon dioksida sama fosil mas gitu. Nah, sebisa mungkin sekarang kita waktunya gitu. Kapan lagi kita reduce gitu ya. Saya juga susah melakukan itu, tapi kapan lagi kita akan melakukan itu. Nah, terus kita kampanyekan hal-hal ini gitu ya. Terus lagi misalkan beberapa orang concern gitu, misalkan dengan spesies-spesies yang lebih kecil, lebih besar gitu. Misalkan beberapa orang concern dengan panda, dengan orang utan, dengan apalagi komodo misalkan gitu. Mereka berusaha untuk melestarikan gitu. Tapi saya pernah baca bahwa ternyata ekosistem itu malah dipengaruhi ya itu oleh makhluk-makhluk yang lebih kecil gitu ya, kodok, tikus, apa segala macam gitu. Nah, ini yang kelihatannya lepas pantauan dari para, dan kenyataannya gitu, kalau kita lihat tadi background extinction terbesar itu sebenarnya adalah di makhluk-makhluk kecil ini ya, di amfibian, di invertebrata seperti itu. Ya, jadi saya sih berharap dengan apa namanya kita buka wawasan cakrawala tentang ini, tentang extinction ini, ya kita mulai sadar gitu bahwa kita yang menyebabkan mass extinction yang saat ini nih. Di saatnya kita rubah hidup kita, apa style hidup kita, ya, menjadi manusia yang apa cukup aja gitu, jangan yang mubazir. Kira-kira seperti itu jawabannya, Mas Cornelis Maranatha. Mudah-mudahan menjawab pertanyaan Mas.
Ya Pak, terima kasih Pak. Berarti bisa kita bilang main concern atau main triggernya itu manusia itu sendiri. Berarti manusia harus menanamkan ini banget ya Pak ya, menanamkan konsistensi buat tetap menjaga gitu ya Pak ya.
Betul sekali.
Mana? Baik Pak, terima kasih banyak Pak.
Ya sama-sama Mas Penulis. Bagaimana?
Oke, the last question from the participant. Thank you for all the question. I'm sorry to inform that our Q&A session is now closed due to the time limit today. And thank you for your all enthusiasm and the question. To end this session, I will give some review and conclusion. I will give it in English. Okay, the mass extinction is a sudden global loss of species with temporal range. Many creatures evolve, but not always get stronger, belongs to their environment, and also they have variative lifespan, so this affecting the mass extinction. 96% of background extinction, like lifespan, affect the mass extinction. For the example, mammals' lifespan is only 1 million of years. There have been a total of 5 mass extinction on Earth, and the biggest being the Permian until late Permian extinction. The LOMA was caused by glaciation and interglaciation periods, a noxic process causing global toxicity and CO2 sequestration. Other causes include gamma ray bursts and global warming. The late Devonian mass extinction is theorized to be caused by bolide impact, supernova, and magmatism or rifting. The Great Dying or the Permian extinction, Siberian or Siberian trap, deep marine anoxic water, elevated H2 sulfate and CO2, ocean acidification. Triassic Jurassic mass extinction was caused by massive volcanic eruption and oceanic uptake of carbon and sulfur dioxide. K or PG mass extinction was caused by the asteroid impact or cyclone impact in the near of the Gulf of Mexico, Deakin Trap, and mega tsunami. 6 mass extinction overly successful bit of humans population, like global warming, pandemic, increasing carbon dioxide, and etc. And the last, I will give it in Indonesia. Proses dari extinction sendiri merupakan sesuatu yang ilmiah, dan seluruh makhluk hidup yang ada di dunia ini pastinya akan mengalami kepunahan. Okay, next up we will like to take a picture together for the documentation purpose. So for those of you who haven't turned on your camera, please do so. Kami akan melanjutkan ke sesi foto bersama. Bagi kalian yang belum menyalakan kameranya, diharapkan untuk menyalakan kameranya untuk segera diabadikan oleh tim dokumentasi.
Thank you. Time to take photo together. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Once again. 1, 2, 3. Thank you.
Okay, thank you to Mr. Erto.
Thank you very much.
And then That is all for today. Thank you to Mr. Randy for the marvelous presentation. We hope to hear from you in the near future. We will also like to thank our sponsor and our support. This event is sponsored by PT Timah, PT PetroChina, PLN Geothermal, PLN Gas and Geothermal, Premier Oil, Pertamina Hulu Energy, Pukas Migas Universitas Trisakti. And also this event is supported by AAPG, IAGI, SMIAGI, IKA Geo Usakti, IPA, SKK Migas, ESDM, AAPG Indonesia, ESRI Indonesia, HMTG, dan juga Perhimpunan Mahasiswa Geologi Indonesia. And for all of this would not have been possible without your cooperation, and thank you to all of the participants for your participation. And then my name is Elisa Nandita Putriana. It has been a pleasure. We hope to see you again on our next event and opening. Thank you very much for your participant and goodbye.
Bye.
Bye, thank you.
Thank you very much. Matur suksma.
Thank you very much too. And I will give again to the committee.
What's next?
For our webinar series, we hope to hear from you all again in the near future. Don't forget that Granite have all these events that will be conducted in the near future.